Mosaic, how are you? Why don't we stand up, have a word of prayer as we enter into worship. Father, we thank you that we can come into your presence, Lord, and enter into a holy place, Lord, by your blood. You've made a way for us to come to you. By coming to us. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus. Lord, we invite your presence here today in our lives, Lord, as we gather together to celebrate you and worship you and learn from you, Lord. We thank you so much for who you are in our lives, Lord, and who you're creating us to be, to reflect you. I just pray that your Spirit would move in the hearts of your people today, in Jesus' name.
Thank you. that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free.
Feel the world is broken.
We do.
You feel the shadows deepen.
We do.
Do you know that all the dark ones stop light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made? Your creation groaning,
it is.
Is a new creation coming,
it is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst,
it is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of?
Every people in tribe. morning, may our hearts cry that out. But may we also treat you as such, that you're worthy of our attention this morning and our engagement, our heart's affection and our worship, our willingness to be transformed by your word and by your spirit, and then our willingness to love one another and love one another well. So Lord, move us this morning, move with us this morning, and may we dance with you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're a kid, grades 5 and below, go to the front. If you're a student, grades 6 to 8, go to the back. If you're not a student or a kid, shake a hand, learn a name, say hello.
How are we today? That was like pretty hot. Well, that was a little louder than I was expecting. Good morning. I'll check one more time. How are we doing this morning? All right, good. That song seemed to get everybody a little jazzed. Got us pumped up, ready to go. Good morning. If you don't know me, I'm Chris, one of the guys around here. And I just want to welcome you to Mosaic this morning, especially if you're new. Welcome. We are thrilled that you are here with us. And want to run through something real quick. If you are newer, just ways to get connected here. First off, for everybody, reminder, we always have lots of information on our Slick Mosaic Mansfield website. So you can always check that out for events and information you need about what's going on around here. Lots of things, and obviously you can ask one of us. Also, a very handy thing, if you look in the back of the pew in front of you, everybody find a connection card. I'm going to make you do this and pull it out. Grab a connection card, pull it out, put that connection card in the air, and wave it like you just don't care. There you go. Some of you get that. Nice. Hey, on that, now look at it. On that card, there's all kinds of ways to connect with us, to sign up for events, to put a prayer request on there, if you'd like to talk to somebody, all those kinds of things. There's lots of things on there. So use those and drop them in the giving boxes at the back and all over the church. All right? Cool? We got that? Men and women. That's most of us in the room at this point. Get excited about October. We've been talking about this a lot. Wednesdays in October, 6:30, child care is provided, and we're going to have a time where men are going to be hanging out with men, women with women, and really good groups that you're going to be going through. There's a series called Be a Godly Man that's a video-driven series for the guys that will watch the video, and then we'll kind of break up into groups and really just kind of get to know each other and build relationship and kind of dig into the stuff that we're being challenged with there. For ladies, Miss Julie McPeak, you might have seen a video or seen her up front. She's going to be leading you through a group called, what was it called, Poor? Poor, that's it. And that's really good stuff. So we want everybody that can to be involved in that. So come on Wednesdays. And there's a kickoff event for the men and the women this week. Tonight is the ladies' kickoff event. Anybody can come to that and connect with other ladies, even if you can't do the Wednesdays in October. You're welcome to come to that. Same thing with the guys. On Saturday is the big event out at Don Starkey's place. It's a beautiful property, and we're hoping for nice weather, and we're just going to like hang out, and there's a fire and yard games and eat meat and ride quads and go fishing and all that stuff. Some of you are more into that. Like Matt was all about that last week. Like, just so you know, I'm not really a gun guy or a fishing guy, but I'm still going to be there hanging out. Okay, so it'll be awesome. Everybody come and join us for those things. I will stop rambling on those. So those events tonight and next Saturday. Then lastly this morning, Fall Festival is coming up on October 19th. This is one of the biggest things we do. We want everybody to be a part of it in some way or another. And if you look online or if you go downstairs in the fellowship hall, there's a bunch of ways that you can sign up to serve at the event. Just so you know, it's like a big old festival right out here in the parking lot and out front, and it's for the people in our community as well as for our church. So you can bring food and supplies. You can come in and serve at one of the stations. There's all kinds of stuff going on, and it really is kind of an outreach slash family church event at the same time. So please get in on that. Please plan on coming on the 19th, and certainly look for ways that you can sign up and you can register online or down in the fellowship hall. Did I say that? Yeah. Cool. That's it for me. Good morning. And Tony came and disappeared. So I guess I'm supposed to stall for a minute. Tony, you coming back? Tony? Okay. I was about to bust out my stand-up comedy routine that I've been working on.
This morning, the first thing I want us to do is I would like for us to envision something this last week or someone this last week that has caused us to be anxious. So whether it was an anxious moment, an anxious circumstance, or a relationship that's brewing and creating anxiety, I want you to think about that, and then I want you to write down just a quick note to yourself in your notes. Take your time. Now, you may be choosing not to write it down, which is perfectly fine, but I do want you thinking about it, because we're going to do something with it in a second. I want you to think about anything, that any circumstance or relationship that might be just causing you anxiety, causing you fear, maybe even causing you anger or angst. I already wrote mine down, so that's why I'm not writing. I don't know about you guys, but I have these periodically. You guys ready for this? You good? All right, so this is what I want you to do with it now. And I'm going to join you in it. I would like us each to just close our eyes and pray about that. Okay? Let's take a moment. Take another moment. Just be still there. Now what I would like you to do is this. I'd like you to go back to your notes for a moment, wherever it is you wrote that down, and I want you to write down what just happened in prayer. It could be nothing. Could be your anxiety grew. Could be that you've received peace or direction. Go ahead and note that for me if you would. Again, take a moment. I'm in trouble because I don't know how to turn sound off on my iPad. I didn't even know it was on. So if I ding, it's because I don't know how to turn it off. I don't dare do that. I'll lose everything. As much as I use this thing, I still mess it up. Okay, so you need your notes. And what we're going to do, I'm going to try to be as concise as possible this morning, because what I want to do is I want to work through a couple of things. So let's do this. You're going to need your Bible. You're going to need some notes. What I need to do is I need you to turn to Luke chapter 11 for me. Luke chapter 11. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about what it is to treat others the manner which we've been treated by Jesus. So if Jesus sees and treats the people in the scriptures the way he does, we can trust that he sees and treats us that way. Then he's empowered us as we've offered our life to him and placed our faith in him, and his Holy Spirit has entered into us. He has empowered us now to love others the way we have been loved, which is really a crazy thought if you think about it. So that's what we've been looking at. And one of the things he says to just really punctuate that is that we're to love our enemies and we're to pray for those who curse us or persecute us or mistreat us. And I realize in the middle of all this, although we have practiced a little bit of prayer, actually if you were in the second service last week, we did. We took a moment, we prayed about certain things in our lives, and then we brought it back in. I realized that there's more instruction to be had in terms of how we perceive prayer. Now, this is going to be brief today, but there's a lot of scripture here that I want you to dig into later this week to give you an opportunity to grow more deeply in this. So look at me at Luke chapter 11. We're going to start at verse 1, if you would. If you don't have a Bible, grab one from the pew back in front of you. You're going to want it. Read along with me, if you would. I'm going to pray while you look. Lord, we thank you for your word and pray that you would just make our spirit ready for this, that our mind would be transformed and our heart would be changed, and your spirit would have full permission to engage with us in a way that not only brings life, but expresses the life that is in us, that is Jesus. We pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. So you ready? Here we go. So it says, one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of the disciples said to him, now this is a really cool thought. Jesus would go to certain places to pray, and oftentimes it was either on a mountain or on a hill or outside the town. We see that Nicodemus had come to him at night up on the roof of a building. Oftentimes rabbis would go up after everyone else had settled down and they'd go up and study and pray. So when it says one day when Jesus was praying in a certain place, when he finished, he had his disciples with him. And one of the disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples. Now this is really interesting to me because the disciples have been walking with Jesus for a while. But apparently up to this point, he had not taught them how to pray. And a couple of Jesus' disciples had actually been disciples of John the Baptist. And so they had watched John pray and apparently had been taught how to pray by John. And the disciples came to Jesus and said, listen, I know John's teaching his disciples how to pray. Would you do the same for us? And I would assume that if you were John's disciple and he taught you how to pray, there was something about Jesus' prayers that were so dynamic and so powerful and so intimate and so something that even they were compelled to relearn how to pray. And it isn't that the 12 would not have known how to pray because they would have grown up with prayer. But there was something about the way Jesus prayed. There was something about being with him while he prayed that made them say, teach me how to pray. Take a deep breath. Please take a deep breath and blow it out. Just blow it out. So here we go. Let's go back to the text. So this is one day when Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of the disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, holy is your name, revered, sacred, hallowed. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Now, this was a classic Jewish prayer in that they were waiting for the Messiah and the coming of the kingdom. But Jesus, knowing that, uses that and reminds the disciples that the kingdom is coming, and it's the kingdom of the Father. And it will come. Look what it says. Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Don't let me worry about anything else. Don't let me fret about anything else. Don't let me be anxious about anything else. Remind me, Lord, that my days are short. The psalmist said, show me the number of my days that I might now live with wisdom. In other words, when I know that I am finite, when I realize that my days are numbered, when I realize this time is short, I will use what I have wisely. Just like anything that we have. If we're down to a half a gallon of milk and I got 4 kids, we realize that we have to use our milk in proportion, right? We need to be wise about the use of our commodities. When our budget is getting tight, we know we have to be wise with what we have left. And Jesus is saying, listen, here's the each day, now pray for your daily bread. Recognize. So the psalmist is saying, know that your days are numbered. Jesus is emphasizing this point, and he's saying, today, each day now. Father, hallowed be your name, and may your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. Remind me, Father, though I love you, I fall short sometimes. Remind me, though my intentions are good, I don't always follow through. Remind me, Father, that sometimes I'm just willful and rebellious. And forgive me. Forgive me when my life doesn't reflect the life that is in me. When the righteousness and holiness that Jesus has made me be, and the Spirit is in me, and everything I have everything I need for life and godliness, Lord, I don't always live that life. And I always don't always live that out that godliness. Forgive me when I don't. Forgive me. Whether it be yesterday's sin, today's sin, or tomorrow's sin. Look what it goes on to say. Forgive us our sins, for we also now forgive everyone who sins against us. As you have forgiven me, Lord, I forgive others. As you have treated me, now I treat others. As I remember your mercy toward me, I am merciful toward others. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And now lead us not into temptation. Now, this isn't saying, God, please don't lead me to temptation. What he's saying is, lead me around or beside or through, or, but Lord, don't let me be tempted. And when I am, be there and be my strength. If that's a struggle for you, put James chapter 1 right there. For God can neither be tempted nor does he tempt. And so what he's saying is, this is what I want you to do. I want you to pray simply. I want you to remember who your Father in heaven is. Know that he is holy and righteous and that he's hallowed. He's worthy of reverence and respect and honor. Know that the kingdom is coming and he's bringing it forward and you get to be a part of it. Remember that your days are numbered, they're short. And so pray for today and don't be concerned about everything else. Put Luke chapter 12 right here if you would, please. And Father, when I don't live out the person that I am that you have made me to be, please forgive me. And help me to forgive others the same way I have been forgiven. And Timothy, Paul said something to Timothy, flee the sinful desires of youth. Well, you know what the word flee means? It doesn't mean get into the middle of it and run. It means to recognize that it's coming and strategize yourself away around it. And that's really what this prayer is. Do not let me be led into temptation, but give me wisdom to go around it. That's the simple prayer of Jesus. That's what he's teaching. This is what he's teaching his disciples. It's prayer so powerful that they cannot help but say, teach me how to do this. And he says, it's okay, all right, sure. Just remember these things. God is God and where he is. His kingdom's coming, be ready for it. Isn't it awesome that he will provide for you everything you need for today? But remember, all you have is today. And his mercy and his grace has forgiven your sins. And as he has been merciful to you, now you be merciful to others. And as you go about your day, trust that he will guide you around the temptations that come. So keep your eyes forward. Do not let your feet go to the left or to the right. Proverbs chapter 4. Keep your eyes forward. So put Proverbs chapter 4 right there. That's what Jesus is praying. That's what he's teaching us to pray. That's how he's teaching us to pray. But there's some more stuff here, so let's keep going. Then he said to them, woohoo! Suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me some loaves of bread. Stop. Anybody ever get that call? It might not have been an actual loaf of bread, right? It might have been prayer. It might have been I need a ride. It might have been my car broke down. It might have been one of my relatives is ill and in the hospital. It might have been, hey, I was just sleeping and I remembered I offended you and I couldn't get it off my chest. It could have waited till morning, but oh, wait. But somehow this friend had a friend stop and he didn't have enough bread. So look what it says. Suppose one of you has a friend and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. I love verse 6. Look what it says. Because a friend of mine on the journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. I didn't realize he was coming. I had already used everything that I had. I prayed for my daily bread, but apparently I needed more, and you're the one I thought of. God put you on my heart. Anybody ever say that to you? And you go, oh, no, thank, great, wonderful, let's work through that. Okay, so look what it says. Because a friend of mine was on a journey and has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. Verse 7. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. Now, I have good friends. I have good friends that really, in general, they can bug me anytime they want. But that doesn't mean that if I'm in bed asleep and my kids are all sleeping and the dogs are down and everything that's happening is needed, everything's done, and somebody knocks on my door, it doesn't really matter how good a friend they are. Right now, I'm ticked. Anybody else? Anybody? When your phone rings at 1 in the morning, your first reaction is, what? What? I love how real Jesus is in this story, because that's exactly what he's talking about. He's saying any one of you, as friends, when somebody comes to your house at midnight and everybody's bedded down and they interrupt you with the knocking on the door, yeah, they're your friend, but what are you doing? That's all of our first response. That's okay. It's natural. But what happens? We come to our senses. We're going to look at this little passage, a little phrase again in a minute. We come to our senses. After we kind of shake the fear, the startle of being awoken, and then the anger of having to go downstairs, and then the annoyance that, okay, it's not, something major isn't happening, but this friend of mine didn't have the consideration to call me earlier. And you take that deep breath and the heart begins to beat a little slower. Right? What happens then? We tend to be a smidgen more agreeable. Just a little. Just a little. But at least a smidgen. Look what it says. Suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. And that seems like a lot of bread, doesn't it? Because a friend of mine is on a journey, and he has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. He's annoyed. He's bothered. He was startled. I tell you, though. Now, you know what's happening in the crowd, right? In the crowd, everybody's going, uh-huh, yeah, yeah. That's exactly, yeah, mm-hmm. I've had that happen before. That Joe, what a dork. Always needs something, and it's always at the worst time. Anybody? 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 Anyone have children? Okay. I can say that because we've all been children, and we've done that to somebody. Okay, so here we go. Suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door's already locked. My children are in bed. If he wakes up, I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, though, he will not get up and give him the bread because he is a friend. I love this moment, because what he's saying is, yeah, you're my friend, but you know what you did? You really bothered me. And I'll be honest with you, my friendship really wanted to end about 30 seconds ago. But I tell you what, you got me up, I'm out of bed, you got a need, you bugged me, I'm at least going to give you your bread. Anybody ever have a friend, you got to give them what you got because they need what you got, but you're really not happy that they came to get it? You don't really necessarily mind giving it up because you got it to give. But man, would you think more next time? Anybody? And so you don't really give them the thing because they're a friend. You give it to them because they're bold. Because to be honest with you, you'd be less annoyed with a stranger in an emergency than you would be a friend who comes and bugs you. Right? A stranger that you'll be startled, but you're like, oh, I'm so sorry. That's too bad. It's nice to meet you. Here's my stuff. But a friend ought to know better. Right? I love the way Jesus is doing this, and he's telling us this is what relationships are like, and I want you to know how to function in a relationship and how your Father wants you to, because how we function in this relationship is going to be how we function with our Father. And then how we function with our Father will teach us how to function with one another. And that's what he's doing here. Verse 7. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me, the door is locked and my children are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you though, this is Jesus speaking, he will not get up and give him the bread because he is a friend, yet because of the man's boldness. Because the man would come at midnight, and he would knock on the door, and he would ask persistently, and make sure you knew the issue at hand. He would play on your sympathy and your generosity. A friend knows how to play us. They know just what to do. They know who they can go to, even if I annoy you. Not only will the man give him the bread, look what it says, yet because of the man's boldness, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. Whatever you need is yours. So I say to you, ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Be bold with God. Go to God. Ask God. Seek him out. Seek his will out. Seek his provision. Seek those things. That's what he had just taught us, right? Seek the Father who's hallowed in heaven. Call him Daddy. It's okay. Right? Then do what? Say, Father, let your kingdom come. But here I am. I need today's bread. I need you to be merciful to me. I need you to help me to be merciful to others. And I need you to help me to guide me through my day, that I would not be tempted beyond my ability to bear. Guide me with wisdom. Isn't that what he just prayed? Isn't that what he just taught us to pray? Now he's teaching us how to go about it. Go right to the Father. Knock on the door. It doesn't matter what time it is. He's your dad. And at first you're going to be reluctant because... Anybody here ever get reluctant to talk to God about something? Like, you know you should, but you're afraid to bring it to him? Anybody? Maybe it's just me. As if God doesn't know already, right? But he does, and yet I still am hesitant to bring it. It's almost like I'm afraid I'm bothering him. Like, God, I've had people say that to me. You know, I really think I should pray about this. How you doing, buddy? I really feel like I should be praying about this, but you know what? I think God's got bigger things to worry about than my little thing. I would love to pray about this, but I can't imagine God having everything to do, and everyone that is, you know, so many people with so many problems worse than my own. How do I dare bring this? And Jesus is saying, no, he's your father. He's your daddy. And I know you're going to feel reluctant. I know you're going to feel like you're imposing. And I know you feel like you're asking more than you feel like you should. But no, come. Don't only come, but come boldly. Come when it's least convenient. Come when you think you're going to be bothering God. That's the moment you have to overcome your own feelings to get to the Father. And know that if an evil man who is angry because you woke him up will give you everything you need, how much more will your loving Heavenly Father? I think that's what happens next. Let's see. You ready? Here we go. Actually, I want to stop for a minute. Do yourself a favor. Stop for a minute. Take a deep breath. Again, blow it out. And do me this favor, write down your thoughts right now. Write down your thoughts. What's been sparked in your mind? Or what is stirring your heart? Just write it down for a second, please. It may refer back to the thing you wrote about at the beginning of the service. It may be something completely different. Yeah. You're welcome. You ready? So let's go a little further. Here we go. Okay. Anybody feel anxious at all right now? Anybody? Isn't that funny? Huh, so do I. So let's do this. Ready? Everybody stop. Put the stuff in your lap. Get comfy. Wiggle your hiney if you need to. That's how I get comfy. Close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Blow it out. And let us pray. Father, we just come before you, even now, and thank you for your word. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for one another. And we thank you for our circumstances. If I were not in the circumstance I am today, I would not be any longer. So I am where I am, and you know where I am, and you'll meet me where I am, and you'll do for me what I need where I am, that I might bring you glory, be at peace with you, and bring your kingdom to others. Father, help my soul and spirit to breathe just like my lungs. And may my breathing be in pace with yours. Take a deep breath. Blow it out. Amen. Let's go further. You ready? Here we go. So it says in verse 9, So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks the door will be opened. Now, I want to stop here for a minute. Who's talking here? Who is this? Is this some guru just talking about prayer and what you might be able to get out of prayer? Is this somebody just trying to teach somebody how to pray? Or is this actually the King of Kings, the Son of the Most High, the one who hears our prayers, teaching us not only how to pray, but promising that our prayers will be answered? Isn't that crazy? That this is the one who hears the prayers and can act on the prayers, who's promising us that he will respond to the prayers. And in doing so, will give us everything we need. It's Jesus talking here, and he's not. This is not ethereal. This isn't just some theory. This is reality, and he's saying, this is how you commune with me. This is how you talk to me. This is how we speak to one another. Come to me at any time. It's okay. I know you'll be afraid. I know you'll be reluctant. I know you'll be apologetic. I know you'll be afraid. I know you'll wish you didn't have to pray it. Now, I know you think you shouldn't be praying it. Tough. Bring it. Bring it. Whoop. Sorry about that. So let's keep going. You ready? Whoo. So we're at verse 11. Here's where the rubber meets the road. You ready for this? Which of you fathers or mothers or guardians or close friends or caretakers? Which of you fathers, if your son or daughter or the one for whom you're responsible, asks for a fish, will you give him a what? A snake instead. Now, I want you to picture in your mind a fish and a snake. Now, at first you think, well, fish and steak, there's nothing alike, right? And that's not necessarily so. They move with the same, in the same fashion. They both wriggle. They both have two eyes and a mouth. They both have scales. There's actually quite a bit of resemblance between a fish and a snake, isn't there? Isn't that interesting? Let's keep going. Which of you fathers, I'm going to just stick with that word now. We have used all my pronouns, so here we go. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will you give him a scorpion? Now you're going, well, there's nothing alike between a scorpion and an egg. Unless, of course, you come upon a scorpion that's nesting. You know what a scorpion looks like when it nests? An egg. Its tail is curled up, its claws are in, and it's oval in shape. Did you know that? It has a hard shell just like an egg has a hard shell. And yet he compares an egg and a scorpion. Why something similar? If we were to go to Matthew, he uses something even more profound. What one of you fathers, if your son comes to ask for a loaf of bread, would you give him a what? A stone. Well, what do you mean? Now, bread doesn't look like a stone. Well, our bread doesn't look like a stone, but theirs did. They had small barley loaves, just little ones. They were hard, like tack, like you had to pull them off. And one laying on the ground, you could not tell the difference between that loaf of bread and a stone. So Jesus continues to use these similarities in his teaching, and he's saying, what one of you would, if your son asked for this, would you give him that? So which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion instead? And if you then, though you are what? What's it say? Though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give you the Holy Spirit who ask him? Now, this is very interesting, because what he's saying is when you ask and seek and knock, and that you will receive. And you'll receive exactly what it is that he thinks that you need, because in Matthew, this same passage, he says, your Father knows you need it before you even ask. And he gives you all these examples of things that seem so different, but and yet if you took a step back, they're actually quite similar. What is he saying? That my Father will give you everything you need. And what's the primary source of need? What is the most fundamental need we have? It's his Spirit. And that, therefore, everything that he gives us after the Spirit will be in line with the Spirit. This is really, really important. Because sometimes, listen to me, sometimes what we ask for, when we get the answer, and the answer wasn't exactly what we were expecting, looks like it, but isn't quite the same. It appears to be, I asked for an egg, but this is a scorpion. God is saying, would I give you a scorpion? Or I'm asking you for the Spirit and the Spirit of wisdom to be able to discern that what I've given you may appear to be a scorpion because it doesn't look like what you asked for, but in actuality, it's an egg. The answer God gives us doesn't always look like what we ask, but it's always what we need. The most profound example in this, because I think in Matthew, Jesus is actually being prophetic. When he was teaching the Jews this, and he said, what's one of you, if your son asked for a loaf of bread, would give him a stone? What had the Jews been praying for generations? The Messiah. But they didn't get what they thought they were going to get, did they? In fact, Peter calls him a stone. Yet Jesus described himself as what? The bread of life. See, I've come to be the bread of the Father, but to you I look like a stone. You've asked for this, and I've given you just what you need, but I realize it's going to take wisdom and time and trust for you to get what I'm doing for you. Does this make sense this morning? I wish we had more time. Ugh, what a bummer. Okay, so go to your notes real quick. And I'm going to at least guide you through the outline of these notes so you, when you go home, it's not like you're trying to put a puzzle together necessarily. So, starting at the top of the notes, you ready? We're to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. The changing of our mind and heart, life and its circumstances. Now, life and circumstances can be overwhelming in such a way as to distract us from what is true. Follow me as I read this, please. The changing of a mind and heart, our life, so that's what God is wanting to do. So life and its circumstances can be overwhelming in such a way as to distract us from what is true, robbing us of the peace we have as God's children and replacing that peace with fearful and anxious thoughts. That's what we were dealing with this morning. Okay? God does not want us to be anxious and distracted, but at peace with him in and through everything, trusting the truth that he is for us. We get that right out of Romans 8. Anxiety, listen to this. Anxiety is a restrictor of the mind. It keeps us from being able to be free in our thoughts. It's a constrictor of the heart. It closes off, it squeezes us and takes the life out of our hearts. And it's the distractor of prayer. Anybody ever try to pray about the thing they're anxious about, but the anxiety is so great they can't pray and they can't get settled in? Anybody? Yeah, me too. So what has to happen is we have to be transformed in the midst of this. Let's keep going. Look what it says. Lies are the fuel for anxiety. But what is a lie? The more we entertain the lie, the tighter the squeeze. And the tighter the squeeze, the more we doubt the truth that our Father loves us. In other words, as that anxiety begins to override us and our mind now is restricted and our heart is constricted and we're struggling in our prayer, we begin to doubt God's love. We begin to doubt God's presence. Philippians 4:4-8, if you're taking notes. So lies are the fuel for anxiety. The more we entertain the lie, the tighter the squeeze. And the tighter the squeeze, the more we doubt the truth that our Father loves us and that he works all things out for the good of those who love him. That's true. These lies often begin as everyday thoughts and concerns in our minds. Just normal stuff. These thoughts and concerns begin to swell as we entertain them. Anybody? All of a sudden, they get bigger and bigger, like a big vortex. and taking up more and more space until they finally overwhelm and distort us. And they begin to cause us to doubt what is true. Now, I want you to follow me here. Not only what is true, but then they cause us to doubt the truth. See, what is true about the circumstance is hidden to me because it's been distorted. But as that happens, now I begin to doubt the truth of what God says he'll do in the midst of it. So first we lose what's true, then we start losing the truth. And look what happens next. Then the one who is the truth. So if all of a sudden I can't see what's true, and I begin to doubt the truth of what God says, and if I begin to doubt the truth, I begin to doubt who? The very God who gave me the truth. And all of a sudden, I'm overwhelmed even more, and I'm being overcome. So, it begins to cause us to doubt what is true, then the truth, then the one who is the truth, and the truth giver. And then, because everything is now out of perspective and proportion, it makes the truth now out to be a lie. Oh, God doesn't love me. God isn't present. God doesn't forgive my sins. I don't even know if I'm saved anymore. I don't know if God could possibly love me where I am. Anybody go through that scenario? Am I the only one? That happens to all human beings. If you're taking notes, put 2 Peter chapter 1 right here. So we go on. So we call out. At this point, we're just frazzled, right? We don't even know where to go. We don't know where to turn. We don't know who to trust. We don't know what to trust. So now we just call out, and hope that maybe God will answer. But not having dealt with the lies, even the gift that God gives us in response to our calling out, because he does answer, because he always does, doesn't look like what it actually is. So I asked for bread, but I'm so screwed up it looks like a stone and I can't imagine that that's bread. He would never answer it that way. What? No! He knows what we need before we ask. The question is, can we see it for what it is God's loving response and intention? Is it true that Jesus said, Jesus said, your Father knows what you need before you ask, so just do it, and he'll respond. Was he lying to us? Or is this a matter about getting our heart and mind aligned with the truth and learning wisdom and relying on God and leaning into God and then learning to trust God? And trusting God is hard. Trusting God is hard. Anybody else struggle trusting God? Because learning to trust God is no different than me learning to trust Jim. As I know Jim, he seems like a decent guy, but would I actually entrust myself to him? No, I don't know him well enough. But over time, as I get to know Jim and I learn to trust Jim, especially if our relationship goes through any trials, what happens? I learn to trust him more and more as I get to know him more and more. But until I get to know him more and more, I can only entrust so much to him. So I'll only entrust what I know I can trust. You know what that is, this relationship between me and Jim? It's an earthly example of a kingdom truth. That as I know God more, I trust him more. As I trust him more, I entrust more to him. Until I trust him, I can't entrust. But once he's proven himself trustworthy, what do? I entrust some more. That's what this is. And it's okay when you struggle trusting God. It's okay. He knows. He's not surprised by that. So let's finish this up. So changing our mind. The transformation of the attitude of my mind is through the renewing of my mind. What I know to be true, comparing my thoughts to the truth. This is really, really important. So, because anxiety causes me to not trust what's true, or to not be able to see what's true, and then doubt the truth, what I need to do is purposely take what this anxiety is doing to me and compare it to the truth. Once I begin to do that, it shows me the truth. Does that make sense? Because the anxiety is a lie. I've got to expose it to the what? To the truth. But in my head, the truth is all messed up. So I got to go where? To the Word. Because the Word is truth. The Holy Spirit, who is truth, then works with the Word to do what? To straighten my mind. So here's a couple things you can do. Right here in your notes. Ready? The first thing you need to do is remember the truth. Man, I wish we could keep going. This is, we got to remember the truth. Anybody just forget the truth sometimes? Like you forget that God does love you. You forget that you're forgiven of your sins. You forget that his mercy is there. You forget that you are secure in him. You forget you have the Holy Spirit. You forget. Anybody else forget? So sometimes you have to do what? Remember. Well, guess what the Holy Spirit's there to do? Make you remember, to remind you. So what happens when we get really squirrely and we just start going down the drain? You know what happens at the very last minute? I come to my senses. What happens? As I put my arms out so I don't swirl down the drain anymore to hold myself up. Boink! And all I have to do now is look up. The Holy Spirit says to me, do you remember your father? Do you remember him? Do you remember him? Do you remember him? Do you remember him? Band, get in place. Everybody else turn to Luke 15. Should I finish this next week? Should we keep going? Okay. But I want to show you what the Holy Spirit does. And I'm not just saying, remember the Father. Jesus actually taught it. You ready? So we're in Luke 15. I think it's 15. Am I right? Yes, 15. Where's my Bible? Thanks. Verse 17. You ready? This is about the prodigal son who went to his father, gathered up all his belongings, went to a foreign country, squandered it in wild living. Poop hits the fan. You ready? Poop hits the fan. Okay, so here we go. I'm just saying that because we all have moments when what? Poop hits the fan. Okay, so here we go. Verse 13, not long after that, the younger son got everything he had, set out for a distant country, and there he squandered his wealth on wild living. After he had spent everything there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He was so hungry that he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. Verse 17, you ready? When he did what? When he came to his senses, he what? What's it say next? He remembered who? His father. He remembered his father. And the father's mentioned four more times after this. He remembered his father's generosity, his kindness, his care. He remembered his father. When poop hit the fan and he's in the drain spinning down and all he could do was hang on, he came to his senses. The Holy Spirit whispered in his ear, do you remember your father? Do you remember him? How merciful, how gracious, how kind, how generous, how hospitable, how wonderful, how wise. Do you remember your father? Where'd the boy go after that? He ran. Where'd the father go? He ran too. We'll finish this up next week. So there are a couple things. Are we praying today? So, remembering our Father. Remembering the one who is so merciful. Remembering the one who made us in his image, who delights in us, who calls us to himself. Remembering his kindness and generosity. Remembering his forgiving spirit. When things are hitting the fan and it's all you can do to hold on and anxiety has overwhelmed you and made you think otherwise, the truth is the Father, to whom the Son points and the Spirit speaks, and we all live under his grace. Today's communion. And I want to encourage each one of us today to take a breath and remember our Father, who the Son is the very and exact image and reflection of, who the Spirit is the expression of, our God, our King, our Daddy, our brother, our friend, our Savior, our strength, our power, our reminder. That is our God. And as we come forward today, as we sing this song, what I'd ask us to do is let that Spirit examine your heart and present the things that are making you most anxious, or the people that are making you most anxious. Give them to Him. Ask Him to work your heart in such a way as to truly respond. And then as you're able, come forward, grab the elements, bring them back to your seat, and we'll take them together. Stand and sing.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Savior. Oh, what a Savior.
Sure, we're doing right now is just recognizing who we just sang to, and frankly, who we just sang with. That when Jesus was speaking to us about prayer, he wasn't just some rabbi standing on a hill telling us something. It's the expression of the Father's heart calling out to us to join him in conversation. What he was doing was pleading with us to understand that the Father loves us so much and wants so desperately for our hearts to connect with his, and for our minds to be straight with his, and for our lives to reflect his. That's what he wants. So as we come to the table today and we take the broken bread, this is what Jesus said. It says that he took a piece of bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body. This is my body broken for you. Remember whenever you eat it. And after the meal, he took a cup and he said, this is my blood. This is my blood. This is a covenant I'm making, an agreement I'm making, a contract I'm making with you, and doing so in my blood. This is for you. Drink it and remember me. And then it says they sang a song. Let's sing a song.
Yeah.
May we believe that truth. That truth. We are yours. You are ours. That truth. That truth. May that which makes us anxious fall at your feet. And may our hearts be freed to love as our minds are freed to believe. And the Spirit in us cries out, Abba, Daddy. Be with us this week, and may we experience you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a wonderful week, guys.